Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning. I invite us to stand together for our call to worship. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known on the earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Find strength to face the day. And in your presence,
Heavenly Father, our gracious and loving God, we come into your presence this morning, God, into this place set aside to worship you, to glorify you, to honor you. God, we gather as the church. We know that this is just one stop in the moment of being the church, a place to come and be renewed and refreshed and revived, a place to come and hear your word, and then to be sent out to share your love and your grace with others. As we come into this moment of worship, God, open our hearts and our minds to your word, to your presence, to the power of your Holy Spirit. Allow him to dwell within us, to dwell within this place, that during this moment we might be revived and transformed. We might be empowered to live the lives that Jesus has called us to live and to worship you in spirit and in truth, not just now, but in every moment of every day. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading today comes from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 4, beginning at verse 17. Now this I say and testify in the Lord, that you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their minds. They are darkened in their understanding, alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. They have become callous and have given themselves up to sensuality, greedy to practice every kind of impurity. But that is not the way you learned Christ, assuming that you have heard about him and were taught in him, as the truth is in Jesus, to put off the old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up that fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. And from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, beginning at verse 14. Then the disciples of John came to him, saying, "Why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" And Jesus said to them, "Can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. No one puts a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment, for the patch tears away from the garment, and a worse tear is made. Neither is new wine put into old wineskins. If it is, the skins burst and the wine is spilled, and the skins are destroyed. But new wine is put into fresh wineskins, and so both are preserved." Let's stand together.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. Thank you. sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God.
Please be seated. As I read from Ephesians this morning, a part about do not let the sun go down on your anger, to give no opportunity to the devil. Remind me of a story I heard the other day. A guy asked a husband and wife what was their secret to their long marriage, and the husband answered, "Well, we never go to bed angry." And they asked, "Well, how is that going?" He said, "I don't know. I ain't been to bed in 6 weeks." So, during the Civil War at the Battle of Shiloh, there's a story of a Union soldier from Ohio who was wounded. He was shot in the arm, and the captain saw that he was injured and barked out an order, "Give me your gun, private, and get to the rear." Well, the private handed over his rifle, and he started running back to the north seeking safety. But after about 200 or 300 yards, he realized that there was no safety going north, and so he turned and he started running west. And after a few hundred yards, he realized there was nothing going to the west, and so he turned and he started running back to the east and kept on going. And after a few hundred yards, he realized there was no safety to the east, and so he quickly turned and ran back to the front of the line and looked at the captain and said, "Captain, give me my gun back. There isn't any rear to this battle." I'll let it sink in for a second or two. The battle that we fight has no rear to it. You and I in a spiritual warfare are in the midst of the battle no matter where we try to run to. The good news for us is that we have the overcoming power of the grace of God. The overcoming power of grace is allowing us, is filling us, is moving in us to help us go and to seek out and to see the battle and to face it with courage and with confidence. Confidence comes from the idea that we know that God is in control, that God is in charge, that God has an ultimate plan no matter what this life looks like. Thomas Brooks wrote, "Remember this, death does that in a moment which no graces, no duties, nor any ordinance could do for a man all his lifetime. Death frees a man from those diseases, corruptions, temptations that no duties, nor graces, nor ordinances could do. Every prayer then shall have its answer. All hungering and thirsting shall be filled and satisfied. Every sigh and groan and tear that has fallen from the saints' eyes shall be recompensed." That is not death, but life, which joins the dying man to Christ. You see, among the wonders of our faith, among the wonders of the overcoming power of God's grace, is the promise of new bodies. We peer through the windows of the Gospels, the stories of the risen Jesus, to catch a glimpse of the bodies that you and I will too have someday. Bodies that will be reborn, resurrected, able to eat and breathe, unhindered by miles or doors or gravity, and able to shine like the sun. Paul taught us about death. He taught us about this overcoming power of God's grace when he wrote these words: "The body that is sown is perishable, but it is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body." Raised imperishable, raised in glory, raised in power, raised a spiritual body. Our new bodies will be sin-free and sick-free and fit for eternally living. We will have minds unmuddled by the lies and lunacy of the world. Hands that only and ever serve the Lord. Eyes wide open to the brilliant sights of all that God has made, the glory of heaven. Ears attuned to the anthems of saints and angels. Voices that will speak only praise and truth. And hearts clean enough and big enough and loving enough to embrace the glory of God. We will be outfitted for a new world free of sin, a whole civilization, a kingdom of people like Christ through and through. Peter says, "But grow in grace. Grow in grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." And these words that we heard from Paul: "You were taught, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, and to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness." But what about now? That's the hope. That's the thing that we long for, this day when these bodies that are filled with pain and agony and aching and someday will wear out somehow, some way. That's the promise of then. But what about the now? And that's the great thing of the kingdom of God, the promise of Jesus Christ. The work of the kingdom, the transforming of the kingdom, the overcoming of the kingdom is already at work in us. As I've said before, one of my preaching professors used to say, the kingdom of God already, but not yet. When Jesus came, he established the kingdom of God, at least in part. He showed us what the kingdom of God should be like. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are those who show mercy. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those. And we know that we fall so short of that we fall short of those expectations, if you will. But in Christ, we are made whole. In Christ, We receive the grace in the here and now, the power to go through this life, in the midst of life, in the midst of the trials and the troubles and the temptations. You see, friends, God gives us many good things. But the most important thing He gives us, greater than any physical healing, greater than any worldly possession, greater than anything that we can see with our eyes until we see it in act, is forgiveness. For every other gift of God without the forgiveness of God would end up being futile. We would simply end up dying in the midst of all of our gifts. We would, like the author of Ecclesiastes says, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. But that's in the midst of the book. So what is the meaning of life? To love God and do His will. To follow Him and be in love with Him and in love with others. The central message of Christianity is that God will forgive your sins. He has forgiven our sins through Jesus Christ. There is no greater news in the whole world than this. Because without the forgiveness of God, without the grace of God, no matter how wonderful this temporal life is, it will come to an end. And without the grace of God, it will be a disastrous ending. Those who are pleasing to God are like the tax collector in the temple. No lofty prayer, no proclamations of His good works. Simply, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That is the heart that God accepts. Not all of our good works, not all, those are in response to the grace of God. God accepts the penitent heart, the heart filled with sorrow over what it has done to God and to his brothers and sisters. Augustine pleaded, Lord, save me from that wicked man. Lord, save me from that wicked man, myself. I don't know if you remember or not, but it's been years ago. I preached a message and I brought into the pulpit with me a mirror, and I held the mirror up while I preached for a while, and I reminded myself and you that whenever I preach, the first person I am preaching to, whenever I challenge and convict, the first person that hopefully I'm doing that to is myself. Lord, deliver me from the wicked man that I am, the wickedness that still lives and wells up in this body. The moments of angst, the moments of selfishness, the moments of pettiness, the moments of John Knox, one of the greatest preachers in the history of Scotland, said, in youth, in middle age, and now after many battles, I find nothing in me but corruption. John Wesley wrote, I am fallen short of the glory of God. My whole heart is altogether corrupt and abominable. And consequently, my whole life being an evil tree cannot bring forth good fruit. Now you might think, well, wait a second. If they're in Christ, why are they? Because the realization that they had, what was it's only in Christ that they overcome the corruptness. I have never will, never can, no matter how many good works I try to do, overcome the corruptness that is in my heart. Only God's grace through Jesus Christ can begin to work in this body of flesh to overcome that, to battle that, to win that. John Newton, in a hymn, wrote words that describe his overcoming power of Christ. He wrote these words. In evil long I took delight, unawed by shame or fear, till a new subject struck my sight and stopped my wild career. I saw one hanging on a tree in agony and blood. He fixed his loving eyes on me, and near his cross I stood. How can it be upon a tree the Savior died for me? My soul is thrilled, my heart is filled to think he died for me. Friends, we come to Christ both in defeat and in victory, in mourning and in joy, because we come to Christ realizing, like all of these great men of faith knew, there is still a corruptness in us, still a desire to do that which you know is against the will of God, that is selfish and self-glorifying and self-pleasing. And yet we come in joy and celebration because we know the gift of Christ, the cleansing power, the overcoming power of the grace of God, that it overcomes the penalty of, it overcomes the filth of, it overcomes everything that I have done wrong. You see, the overcoming power of grace empowers me to put off the old self, as Paul writes. Your hearts should be strengthened by God's grace, not by obeying rules. That's from Hebrews. Who then will condemn us? Will Christ? No. He is the one who died for us and came back to life again for us. You know, before you and I were saved, we were like radios with only one station. Everything we heard was from the vantage point of the old self. When you come to Christ, a new station has been added to our lives, and now we have to decide. And they battle. The other day I was trying to listen to 96.5, and I was coming into town, and all of a sudden it went from 96.5 to some country western song, and everybody was getting their dogs back. I don't know what the heck was going on, but anyway. So I was listening, and so then I had to switch over from 96.5 to 93.7. And it came in clear again. You see, as we go through life, life is like a bunch of radio stations. One of them is the Savior of the world. One of them is the one who is leading us in the right direction, giving us the right thoughts, the right words, the right answers. And sometimes as we go through life, with all our busyness and all the stuff going on, our radio station gets a little bit out of kilter. We get into a place where everything else is competing with it. And then we have to decide, okay, are we going to let that one come in and we're going to listen to that station rather than the station we know is right? Or are we going to switch channels? Are we going to switch stations and bring it back into focus? And once we're saved, then we have the grace empowers us then to turn ourselves, to tune in to the power and the truth of Jesus Christ. It gives us the overcoming power to put off the old self. But you know what? That's not enough. That's not enough. You know, I remember, I don't remember which grandson it was. It was the grandson, not the granddaughter. But they were out playing. Love my grandsons. They're boys all the way through. They were out playing in the backyard. It had rained, and they were digging for worms, and Lord knows what else they were digging for. But they came in. One of them came in, and he was covered head to toe, clothes, body, everything, in mud and whatever else he may have gotten on him. So we told him to go in the bathroom, take off his clothes, and jump in the shower. Well, he goes in the bathroom, takes off his clothes, jumps in the shower, gets all showered up. Some of you know where this is going, don't you? Comes walking back out in the old dirty clothes. Grandma says, "What are you doing?" "Well, you told me just to take a shower, and I'm going back outside." "No, you're not. Go back in there and get your dirty clothes off. And now you got to shower again because you got mud on." No, you know, it just so often that's what we do. We try to put off. You know, we accept Christ. We come to Christ. He gets us clean. And then we try to put the old clothes back on, and we think we're going to go out and serve the world and love one another with that, and we don't do that. It doesn't work that way. Because then it says, Paul says, he doesn't just say take off the old self. He says then put on the new self. And the overcoming power of grace empowers us, allows us, shows us how to put on the new self. You see, when you take a shower, you don't put the same clothes back on that you had on before, usually, hopefully. If you did, you'd be canceling out the benefit of the shower. But when you were showered in the blood of Christ, you were bathed in the blood of Christ, you were cleansed from all your sins. You know, I know that sounds gross to some of you. And it kind of, yeah, I guess it kind of does to me too, thinking about being washed in blood. But you know, the scriptures are pretty amazing. It says that when we were washed in the blood, we don't come out in the red, we come out white as snow. Jesus is the greatest spray and wash of all time. He's the one that comes in, and I don't care how deep that stain is in your life. I don't care how far that wound goes down. But when you come to Christ, in the moment he begins to heal that, in the very moment there is total forgiveness, but over the moments of time, he begins to heal that wound. He begins to heal. He begins to cleanse and forgive. Forgiveness is when the moment, but it continues on till it's complete. That's why I think that when they were asked, how many times should I forgive my brother, Jesus says, not seven times, but 77 times. Or seven times 700. Seven times seven. What was he saying? Was he telling us, okay, start, you know, get a score sheet out there and say, okay, that's one, that's two. Until we got up to, no, that's not what he was saying. He wasn't saying 70 times 7, added up 490. 7 is the number of perfection and completion in Scripture. And so he's telling us to keep on forgiving, to keep on accepting forgiveness until it is complete, until it has come in its fullness. That's why for some of us, we keep going back to Jesus with the same sin. Maybe we haven't fallen into it again, but we're still trying to experience that total loving forgiveness that he wants to give to us. Here's what Paul says. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Your old sinful self has died, and your new life is kept in Christ, in God. We don't have to achieve our new life. We don't have to hold on to our new life. We do have to put on our new life. And once we put it on, we have achieved it and we are held on to by Christ. Let me share a story I know I've shared before, but it's about the dude at the business party, and they're mingling around talking to each other, and he has a lapel pin with a bulldog on it. And some guy comes up to him and says, oh, I see you must work for Mack Truck, huh? And says, no, why would you say that? He said, well, you got a bulldog on your lapel. I says, I figured you were working for Mack Truck. He said, oh, no, no, no. He said, I'm a Christian, and this bulldog pin is to remind me of how hard I hold on to God, the tenacity with which I hold on to God. Well, the other guy happened to be a Christian as well, and he said, well, that sounds really good, except I think you got it backwards. He said, what do you mean I got it backwards? He said, well, it should remind you of the tenacity with which God holds on to you. That's the truth of the gospel. You and I at times will let go of God. We will turn away from God. We will doubt God. We will question God. But God will remain faithful. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. What can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus? Somebody give me an answer. What can? Anything? Is there anything out there? Nothing. Nothing. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Because we were bought with grace, not with good works. We were bought with God's love, not with our love of God, but God's love of us. He called us. He brought us. He came for us. The overcoming power of grace empowers us to renew our thinking. To renew our thinking. Man came home from a fishing trip and said, I caught me a 20-pound fish. His wife said, well, wait just a minute. And she ran to the back and she brought out a scale. The man said, well, you know, it might not be quite 20 pounds. See, sometimes that's the way we try to finagle things through because we think we have to with God, but we don't. We can be honest with God. We can stand with God. We understand the standard to measure the information is through the Word of God, and the Word of God says that I have called you and you are mine. Everything, Paul writes, everything, and I do mean everything, connected with that old way of life has to go. Get rid of it and then take on an entirely new way of life, a God-fashioned life, a life renewed from the inside and working itself into your conduct as God accurately reproduces his character in you. Let me just quickly say a word before I finish up here about the gospel lesson this morning, because I really haven't gone to that. But in that, remember, Jesus was talking to them and said, you don't take a new piece of cloth and sew it onto an old, because if you wash it and it hasn't been shrunk and the other part's shrunk, it will shrink and it will, or you don't put old or new wine into old wineskins. In those days, they would take like the leg of an animal and they would cut it off at the top and then cut it off at the hoof, and they would take the skin off. They would not cut it. They would pull it off, and then they would stitch one end back up. They would pour the wine into the other end and seal that back up. And that's where they left the wine the juice to become wine. Well, after a while, those would become brittle. And so if you poured new wine into an old wineskin, eventually it would become so brittle and the wine expanding would just burst it. And all of that wine, I mean, this is not a little pouch you hold on your belt. This was like a big, you know. And so a lot of wine would get wasted. And that's what he's talking about, to put the new wine. And so what he's talking about there is that they were trying to mix the old ways of Judaism, the laws and the rules and following the rituals, not the moral law. He wasn't doing away with the moral law. He said he came to fulfill the law, not to do away with the law, but to fulfill the law. Jesus fulfilled the rituals that we no longer have to do, because those were outward things. Outward things of trying to please God, to bring forgiveness, to get forgiveness. Jesus is saying, no, I'm coming inside of you to clean you from the inside out. I'm coming to live in you, to give you new power, to empower you to live holy lives. I'm setting you free from the rituals and all the sacrifices that used to be. They're no longer, and now I am the sacrifice. I am the one, the final one, who died for you and lives for you and will show you the way. For God is at work within you, helping you want to obey him and then helping you to do what he wants you to do. I read a story about an old black preacher, and he was just recently had gone through some kind of big trouble. I don't know what the trouble was. But he was with his part of his congregation, and they were getting together and they were worshiping and they were doing some stuff, and it came time for prayer, and the old preacher started to pray. And here's the prayer that he said. Listen, this is awesome. Dear Lord, we thank you for being with us during this difficult time. When Moses and the children of Israel were caught at the Red Sea, you didn't lead them over it or around it or under it. You led them through it. And now in the same way, when we are in trouble, you don't lead us over it or around it or under it. No, Lord, you lead us through it. And we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, for our deliverance. And he said, amen. And he sat down. That is the overcoming power of God's grace. He is going to take us through our battles. Remember Isaiah 43, when you pass through the waters, when you pass through the floods, when you pass through the fires, they will not overcome you, they will not burn you. For I, the Lord, your God, am with you. And I love the next couple of verses. I'm gonna go to it quick. Here. I don't want to mess it up. This old mind don't always work so good anymore. Here's what he says. Let me read it to you. I want you to take this to heart, because if you know God, this is your promise. This is he's speaking to you. Just like last week we talked about the apple of his eye, and you are the apple of his eye. Today we're talking about this, and he's saying these things to us. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, He who formed you. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. And then here's what I really want you to hear this morning. Because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you. Fear not, for I am with you. I don't know, but I need to hear those words right now in my life. And I know there's a bunch of you that need to hear those words right now in your life. You need to know that the overcoming power of God's grace is there for you. That He is bigger than every single thing we face. There is no river too wide, no ocean too deep. There is no fire too hot. That He will not be there with us. He may not take us out of it, but He will take us through it. And as I started this message today, what's on the other side when He takes us through it is glory. Your whole life on earth might be filled with trouble and pain, but that's not your whole life. That's not my whole life. When our days are over and our days are finished here, He says to us, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and give you hope, to give you a future. Jesus says, those who hold on till the end, those who keep their faith to the end, will be with me forever. For I go to prepare a place for you. He may not take us around it. He may not take us over it. He may not take us under it. But I know my God will take us through it. Let's pray. Risen and reigning Lord, truly you are a high priest who has passed through the heavens. Truly you were tested as we are and yet were without sin. With boldness we approach your throne, deeply assured of your mercy and your grace in our time of need. Your rising and your reigning give hope to your people. May all who live without hope today taste and see the goodness of God. Your rising and your reigning call us, your people, to testify to your goodness. Equip each of us today to be bold witnesses of the resurrection news. Your rising and your reigning call all nations of the world to stop their scheming and seek your peace. May your Spirit convict all people to submit to your rule and to pursue true peace, the peace that passes understanding. Not peace like the world gives, but the peace that Jesus gives. Your rising and your reigning call each of us to turn from the path of death to the path of obedience and life. Send your Spirit to strengthen our resolve and help us to live as people of life and light. Your rising and your reigning bring life and light and healing. May all who suffer in the valley of the shadow of death, in the wilderness of illness and disease, know your healing presence. Your rising and your reigning are first fruits of all that is to come, justice and joy and peace in the Holy Spirit. May your kingdom come quickly, Lord Jesus. May we, your Easter people, your resurrection people, your overcoming people, never fail to bless and thank you for your immeasurable love and sure promises. All praise to you, risen Christ, who with the Father and the Spirit lives in perfect communion with you forever and ever. And now with the confidence of children of the Father, let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. That is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand together.
Nothing good in me. You are love, you are love, on display for all to see. You are light, you are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you are hope, you have covered all my sin.
Sing, no other name, Jesus.